morning, Mount Olive. It's good to be here this morning with you, and we hope that you've enjoyed your morning so far. We're looking forward to a good service this morning. If you're a guest with us today, we want you to feel welcome. We want to know who you are. In a few minutes, we're going to have a time for fellowship. We're going to come by and shake your hands. We also want you to put your name on a card or the flap of your bulletin and tell us who you are so we can get back with you the next day or two. Please do that for us if you're our guest today. There's a couple of announcements that they're not in the bulletin this morning, we want to go over. Don't forget about the Go Tell Crusade starting this evening. It's at the Northeast Tiger Football Stadium. It starts at 7 o'clock tonight, tomorrow night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night. And we want you to be there and invite your coworkers, friends, neighbors, family to come and hear the gospel preached, hear worship, and be a part of that. We are dismissing tonight's service and Wednesday night service so that our church can take a part, can be a part of that as well. Also, Ladies Shoulder to Shoulder Conference is coming up April the 27th through the 28th. There are sign-up sheets for that in the back and in the Sunday school window. Lady, if you want to be a part of that, sign up and let them know what days you can be a part. It's going to be a really good event. And if you have any questions or you want any more details, please see Miss Judy Huddleston. She can help you with that. And then there's going to be a love offering this morning for the Carpenter family to help with the funeral expenses for Elena Carpenter's father-in-law, Derek's dad, and that'll be this morning, and we'll also do that next Sunday as well if you're not prepared this morning, so please help us out with that. And then don't forget the announcement in the bulletin this morning about the military shut-in list. Please add that to your list if you've picked up one. If not, grab one and add this one to that. We do want to try to keep that opportunity for you to write letters and pray and be a part of ministering those shut-ins and military people. So this is one that we want you to add to that. And then I got a couple of prayer requests this morning. Please be in prayer for the Dan Davis family. Also pray for Connor Kaisers. He had surgery this past week and is recovering from that. And then please be in prayer for Miss Lisa Baggett. She is in Minnesota waiting to get home, and be in prayer for the boys. And Brother Anthony, as he's having to hold down the fort too, so y'all keep him in your prayers as well. So be prayer for a safe flight home very soon, I'm sure. So let's bow for a word of prayer now. Father God, we do thank you. God, we thank you for this opportunity this morning. Father, we thank you for just the opportunity to let us worship together. We thank you for those that's made it here. And Father, we just pray. God, we pray for this service, that it will be about you and not about us. God, we pray that you would bring us to your feet this morning, God, that we would truly worship you, Father, that we would not be about our ambition or our things and our wants, but God, this morning it would be about what you want for us. And God, may us fall into your arms in that respect. God, thank you so much for these men that serve our church so well, Brother Anthony and Brother Stanley. God, bless them this morning. God, I pray that you would honor their preparation and honor their study time and honor all the things that they put into this. And God, we pray that you would be glorified through what they do this morning, God, that it would not be about them. God, you'd almost move them out of the way. And God, you would just speak and work through them this morning. God, we pray for this time, in this hour, at this moment, that you would be glorified, that you would be lifted up. God, use our church to be a beacon of light in this community. God, we pray for this crusade that's happening tonight and the next few. May there be an outpouring of response and support from our community. God, may there be something that we can't even do that's only you that can be done, and through this Go Tell Crusade, may it be a response of salvation and a response of rekindling of the fire to go and to be a part of making a difference in this world, not for our glory, but 100% for your glory. God, I thank you so much again for the opportunity to be here today. Thank you for your son Jesus and the opportunity to worship him. That's the reason we're here, and in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and have a time of fellowship, please.
Good morning, Mount Olive. Y'all can have a seat. Brother Anthony will stand y'all back up in just a second. I'm just going to talk to y'all real quick. I know that we've heard a little bit over the last few weeks about the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Our goal is $3,500. NAM's overall goal is $70 million. But every little bit counts in that, right? So the last time I checked with Miss Helen, we had only taken up about $2,300 for it. So we have three Sundays left because we're going to take up through the end of April. And the reason that I specifically wanted to talk to you guys is because I was privileged to be a NAM missionary at one point in time in my life. I grew up in this church, and this church instilled in me a strong, strong love and passion for missions. And after I got finished with undergrad school, I was able to be selected to be one of NAM's missionaries. And so I served in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, suffering at the beach. It was rough, y'all. it was bad. But I will tell you guys this. There's a few things that I learned from that experience. And one of the things is, but really a lot of the things I learned on my very first day. That ever happened to y'all at a new job or something? Very first day, you're like, okay, I know what I need to know. So one of the things that I learned is my boss, I worked for a Baptist association in that county that had 77 Baptist churches as a part of it. There was also another Baptist association in the county that had 42 churches. So there was 119 Baptist churches in this one county in South Carolina. Now, Horry County is the biggest county east of the Mississippi, so it is a large county, but 119 Baptist churches in this one county, okay? One of the things I said to my Sunday school class this morning, that as I look back on that experience now, I wonder, with 119 Baptist churches in one county, why in the world did they even need a missionary? And that's a good question, y'all, one that I think we all should think about as we sit here this morning. So one of the things, first things my boss told me, he said, Amanda, we go to certain places. Some of them you don't need to go to by yourself. And I said, why not? He said, because they're probably not safe. So as y'all can imagine, one of the first things I did was go to one of those places by myself. My mama says I'm stubborn. I don't fully believe her. But my experience at that place, which was not a dangerous one, by the way, God protected me in all my ignorance. God protected me. But one of my first experiences there on that very first day was a young man who came up to me. And as I was talking to them, I was getting to know some of the people in this neighborhood. This kid was 11 years old. And I was talking to him about becoming a Christian and being a Christian. And he looked at me and he said, well, why would I want to do that? And before I could answer the question, he said, if I do that, he said, that means I can't cuss those kids on the bus anymore. That means if I decide I want to smoke, I can't do that. That means I can't be mean to people anymore if I become Christian. And y'all, in that moment, my heart absolutely broke, because somewhere what it meant to be a Christian and what it meant to love Jesus and to be a part of his family had been sorely miscommunicated to him. And so, you know, it made me realize that, you know, a lot of people may know about being a Christian, but they don't know about being a Christian, right? And that my goal and my mission as a missionary there in that area was not to slap them with the Bible and tell them all the things they were doing wrong and they needed to get right. It was simply to share the love of Christ and who he was and what he came for, and that he loved them above all else, above all else. The other thing, same day, first day, once again, Coastal Carolina is where I was, one of the universities. They had this big day, I don't even remember what they called it, but our little group had set up a booth, and I had this young man come up, a college student. His name was Will, I'll never forget him, and he asked me what we were doing, and he asked me where I was from, because I didn't talk like him, he said, and I told him, and he said, well, what are you doing here? And I said, it was my first day here, and I told him what I was doing, and he said, well, I don't really know anything about Jesus. And I said, you don't? And he said, no. I said, well, it's your lucky day. And so I started talking to Will, and I will tell you guys that he became a Christian within a few months, and that God gave me the opportunity just to minister to him the whole time that I was there, and it was really, it was a blessing to me, because not only did I get to see his ups, but I also got to see his downs. and to let him know that, you know, God didn't promise us that it was all going to be okay and that it wasn't going to be hard. I watched him lose friends. I watched him go through difficulties with his family, people not understanding how God had changed his life. But I was just so grateful to be able to be a part of that. That being said, the NAM offering is what supports missionaries. These North American missionaries who serve all over the United States and Canada both, there's over 5,000 of them. And your Annie Armstrong gift, 100% of it goes to those missionaries. And they're serving in all kinds of capacities. I was what they called a resort missionary because Myrtle Beach is such a huge resort town. But they have them all over the country, and a lot of them do plant churches. And they just share the love of Christ. Many of them have left their families and their homes to do what they feel like God has called them to do. By the way, God has called all of us to be missionaries. He's called you to be a missionary here in this county and wherever it is else that God puts you. Don't tell me you're not surrounded by people who are not Christians, because you are. Whether you realize it or not, you are. One of the reasons for this crusade that's going on this week is that 82% of people in Prentice County are unchurched. That's a staggering statistic. And a lot of us are just not bold enough to talk about Christ. Y'all, please don't believe that that everybody around you has heard of him or knows about him. Don't assume that. Make sure that you're sharing people and that you're asking. And that's what these NAM missionaries do all the time. So I ask you guys, number one, to pray for them. Understand that they live life just like you do. Okay? They get calls from the school too. Okay? They do. They struggle in their marriages sometimes too. They struggle with their finances too. They are not perfect people. And they have everyday real-life challenges just like you guys do. And so, y'all, please make sure that that they are a part of your prayer list and somebody that you're praying for every day. I'll never forget 1 year while I was there coming home, around the time of my birthday, and coming in this church as I was home, and Miss Ernestine telling me that she was so excited. My name had been in their WMU book because it was my birthday month, and that they had prayed for me. And I'll never forget her telling me that, because it meant so much to me that somebody would take time out to specifically pray for me while I was on the mission field. And so, Miss Ernestine, thank you still. And y'all, that's what all those missionaries need, is people every day taking time out to pray for them. The other thing is, pray about how God would have you give, sacrificially give. This is something that, you know, I know that you guys want to support. It's something that I want to support. And just pray about how God would have you give to this wonderful organization and to all these missionaries around the world and around this country who are depending on us to help support them. So thank y'all. Brother Anthony.
Amen. Let's stand this morning as we sing, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Thank you.
What a friend we have in Jesus. Hymn this morning, let's sing "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." I want to ask you to stand, and we're going to do the first, second, and last verse. That is number 305 if you want to use your hymn.
No way. Thank you. desperation, without hope, walk the shell of a man. But then a hand with a nail print stretched downward, just one touch and a new life began, and the old rugged cross made the difference in a life bound for heartache and defeat. I will praise Him forever and ever for the harshness and anger. Little feet run in terror to hide. But now those walls ring with love, warmth, and laughter. Filled with sad, sad, ashen faces, and without hope, death has wrapped them in gloom. But at the side of a saint there,
amen. Thank you, Brother Anthony. Great message and song. And let me tell you, I sound loud. Okay. I wasn't even talking that loud. I didn't think. Okay, good. So, that old rugged cross, well, here it is. It's why we reach out. Because it does make the difference, right? It makes the difference for all of us. And so we reach out and we hold out hope. We hold out truth, we hold out Jesus, we hold out the Word of God to all, because we know that's what makes the difference in every person's life. So in the church, we reach out. We reach out. We continually reach out. The crusade we're having this week is about reaching out. It's about reaching out to go tell the lost about Jesus, telling them to come and hear the gospel proclaimed, because the gospel will go out to those hearts and to those lives, to those ears, so that they can hear and have an opportunity to be to respond to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the church, we reach out, and our arm ought to be long as we reach out all around us to our community and indeed to the world. As Amanda talked about this morning, our North American missionaries reaching out to North America. Our international missionaries are reaching out to the world. We right here are reaching out to our community, and we recognize what the Bible says in Isaiah 59:1, "Behold, the Lord's arm is not shortened that it cannot save, nor is his ear heavy that he cannot hear." The Lord's arm is not shortened that he cannot save. Now, we don't, seems like we don't see all that many people anymore, but the only way to have eternal life is to be saved. Saved from our sins, because Isaiah goes on to say, "But your iniquities, your sins have separated you from your God." I mean, that's what separates us. But the Lord is able to save. He does save. He wants to save as we repent, as we place our faith in Jesus, and as we, the church, take our responsibility seriously to reach out and be the church. So I'm beginning this morning a series on the church, taking time to be the church. That is, making sure that we are reaching out. But before I talk even in a message about reaching out to the community around us or reaching out to the world around us, I want us to think in terms of reaching even just down the pew from where you're sitting to one another. Reaching out to your own church family. Reaching out to folks who come in on Sunday to worship with us, not necessarily even just the members of our church, but the people who sit on the pews next to us and near us and around us Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. So think about that right now. Think about the folks that are sitting on the pew next to you. And I know we're like most Baptist churches. We've got our place. We've got our spot. We've got our seat. I already, after about 6 months, know just about where everybody's going to sit when they come in on Sunday morning. And I look at, if I look at a particular spot and you're not there, I think you're not here. You might be somewhere else. I'll locate you. But, you know, I just kind of know now to look, and I know just about where you sit. So I want you to think about the people that sit in the pew around you. How well do you know them? How well do you know them? You sit by them on Sunday morning. You sit around them. We have a little talk, you know, before church starts, probably with the folks who sit around you. We have a fellowship time after the welcome and prayer. And we go and we speak to everybody. We talk to each other and one another. And we greet folks. We want to make sure we greet our guests when we do that as well, because we want folks to feel welcome here, because they are welcome, whether they're a member here or not. We want you to feel a part of our church family and certainly a part of worship. So I want us to think in terms of taking time to be the church and reaching out to one another in our church family. Acts chapter 2, a marvelous chapter in the Bible that speaks of the early church and how they connected with one another and how they worshiped the Lord together and how they sought to minister to the needs of one another. Now this will be familiar to you as I read it, Acts chapter 2, and I'm just going to read in this message verses 46 through 47. Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 46, and then we'll also read 47. I know you've already stood a couple of times this morning, but I think it's so important that if you're able to stand, we stand to respect and honor the reading of God's word this morning. Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 46. "So continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved." So Luke, the writer of Acts, is giving us here a synopsis of those people who had been saved and were coming together. Verse 41 says, "They who gladly received his word were baptized. There were about 3,000 souls added to them." So 3,000 people added to the church at that particular time. And so they're all babes in Christ. They're new believers in Christ. So they've got to learn. They've got to grow. They've got to know more about Jesus. At this time, the majority of the New Testament was not even written. And in fact, probably none of it at this particular time, which we read about. And yet they had the apostles there who had been taught by Jesus himself, who'd been commissioned by him to go and preach the gospel and teach the people to observe, to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said, I'll be with you. I'll be with you in that. And so they have to learn how to be the church. They have to take time to be the church God's called them to be. I remember several years ago, I was talking to a man who had come out of a church split. He and several others left a particular church because something went on about the pastor. I don't know, but as happens quite often, there was a group that pulled out, and they decided to start their own church. They said, we're just going to go somewhere else. We're going to begin our own church. And he said, what we're going to do is just meet together, and we're just going to go through the book of Acts, and we're going to try to find out what the church is supposed to be, what the church is supposed to look like, because we don't even know what a New Testament church is supposed to be. Well, I was sad at that saying, because he and many others of those who were pulling out had been in church most of their lives, and it was sad that they didn't have a grasp or an understanding of what a New Testament church is supposed to look like. So we're asking God to show us today and strengthen us. We know we're asking him to open our eyes wider spiritually so that we can know. Father, thank you for your word. We ask you to bless it this morning, bless the reading of it. Bless the hearts of those who are hearers today, all of us here this morning. Speak to us, Father. Help us to follow you in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. I love when a church does come together to go and reach out in the community around us, and certainly you are a church who has done that. But I want us to think in terms as well, also, as I've mentioned here, about reaching inward, reaching towards one another and reaching out to one another in the pew that is around you and to our church family. One of the things we always know when we go to a church, especially a Baptist church, is that the greatest prospect list you're going to find in a Baptist church is going to be its membership list. Because there are always members on a roll that don't attend regularly. Some people haven't attended in a year, some in 5 years. Some have been absent so long the FBI couldn't find them. I mean, we have people on our rolls and we just don't know where they are, or we lose touch, or they stop coming, and so we forget about them, and we forget that we need to reach out to the members of our church and reach out, show them the love of Christ, and that we want them to come back and be a part of our assembly, a part of our worship time, a part of the life of the church, the life of this church. And so to do that, we have to get to know one another, right? I want to know, and you want to know, each other's joys, our hurts, our griefs, our heartaches, our good times, our blessings, all of those things. We ought to care enough to want to know about one another and get to know one another and do, as so many of the young preachers say today, do life together. Let's do life, let's do the Christian life together. Otherwise, we just become content to see each other once a week, shake hands, smile, pat them on the back, make a little bit of small talk, and perhaps that then will be all. Now, what I've observed about Mount Olive is that you are a friendly, loving church, that you do love one another, that you are very friendly to one another. However, I would give you one caution. It's the caution that I give to every church that I go to. Sometimes we get so content with being friendly to one another that we forget to be friendly to new folks that come in. And we don't do it on purpose. It's not that we're intentionally trying to shun anybody new, but we do get to know each other, and we love each other, we want to be friendly, and so we think we're a friendly church just because we're friendly to one another. But what about the folks, again, that are coming to visit, the folks that or out in the community that we want to reach? What about folks that we just don't know that well yet? We want them to feel as comfortable as we do, don't we? We want them to feel as comfortable as we do around one another. We don't want it to be awkward at all. We want them to know that we love them, we care, we're glad that they're here to worship with us. We want them to be a part of what God's doing in all of our lives. And so we want to become more intentional in reaching across the pew to love one another. So in the book of Acts here, Luke tells us again about the early church and how they reached out to one another, how they had simplicity of mind. Sometimes we make things too hard in the church, you know. We make things too complicated. We see that they reached out to connect, and they were continually, it says daily, with one accord in the temple. And so I have people say lots of times, well, why do we have church on Sunday night? Why do we have church on Wednesday night? And indeed, there are quite a few churches that are doing away with Sunday night worship time and Wednesday night worship time, and they're just doing just a Sunday morning. And, you know, I don't see here that we have a biblical mandate on times and how often or any of those things. But when I look here, I do see that the early church continually daily in the temple. So they were worshiping, they were continuing to worship daily, every day. And so we're just doing Sunday and Wednesday, okay? And so when I think about that, I think about how God is directing us to get to know one another. That's what they were doing. They were basically getting to know one another and worshiping the Lord together. So I want us to hear this morning, and again, this is going to be in several sermons, how God is directing us to relate to one another across the pew. Because we have the love of Jesus in our hearts, we're saved, you know, we're a member of this church, and we have guests that are here today as well. And so we want to reach out to one another here today and in the future. So to do that, I want to say to you, number one, that we need to get to know our church family. Let's take time to get to know our church family. So again, when we look at the scripture here in verse 46, it says, so continually daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness, simplicity of heart, praising God, having favor with all of the people. God was saving people and adding them to the church. So when he added them to the church, they had to take some time to get to know the church, to get to know one another. Now here's the thing we say today, and it really is true. Time is a really precious commodity. It is. I mean, you know, I was just thinking today, I mean, here April is already half gone. Soon, this year will be half gone. Time goes by so very quickly. It's what we do with that time that makes the difference, right? It's redeeming the time that Paul tells us about, to make the most of it, to redeem the time that we have. And so often, we spend a lot of our time really doing kind of some useless things. And one of those things, I think, deals with technology today. Technology can be a really good thing, right? But technology can also take up much of our time. And the way I see it, it keeps us often from connecting on a personal basis with others. Now, obviously, in New Testament times, they didn't have that type of technology. And so, you know, they could spend time with one another, get to know one another. And that's important for us. Parents, I want you to know it's important for your children, okay? I know they've got their iPads and got their, I started saying Nintendo, but that dates me about 20 years. Whatever the games are they play today. You know, and if you're not careful, they'll end up spending hours of time doing that. And TV is the same way. And you get in the doctor's office, you know, or somewhere else where you're waiting, and everybody's on their phone, you know, and hardly anybody's talking and visiting. Everybody's looking on their phone. And, you know, I've got mine, and I'm guilty of it sometimes as well. You know, I'm checking my email. I'm checking, you know, my messages and that sort of thing. And those are things that we have to do. But we want to make sure that we're connecting, though, on a very personal basis. I mean, I believe that's what the New Testament church did. And it's going to take some time for us to do that. And we might have to put our devices away, you know, to be able to do that, to spend some time with folks and spend some quality time to get to know them. Otherwise, some app on your phone or Facebook or somebody you chat with on the internet becomes your friend, and they're at a distance, and perhaps you never even meet them or see them or talk to them in person. We might be connected on the internet server, but it's not the same thing as being connected to real people. The Bible teaches us that the church is like a family, right? And family needs to spend time together. And the more you spend time together with your family, the more you get to know them. And the more you get to know them, the more you get to appreciate them, right? And I know the more you get to know somebody, the more you get to know our own little quirks, you know, and those type of things. But still, it gives us that bond that we can't get any other way. unless we just take the time to be the church to one another and to share with one another and to help one another and to pray with one another and to let God use us to draw us together and become connected like He wants us to be. I always refer to the church as a family. We're a family. We are God's family here in this church. And so that's one of the reasons why, of course, it's important for us to come together and worship, come together on Sundays like we do in big group time. But, you know, one of the ways that we take time to get to know one another as well is small group time. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but not just small group time, but even times outside of the church setting where we go to camp. If you get an opportunity to go to youth or children's camp, or a mission trip, and we get to work together. Or even a Saturday work day where a bunch of guys are over at the house, you know, working and just kind of getting to know one another and picking at one another and that sort of thing. I mean, it's really important. Ladies, you know, coming together for Bible studies and other times of fellowship together. It really is important. So we need to connect with our brothers and sisters in Christ. It's going to take some time. We need to do that at least two levels. And let me share those with you so I can go further into detail about that. One of the ways that we take the time to be the church and connect is through worshiping together. It's through worshiping our Lord together, like we're doing here, like we're doing now, like we will do at the crusade, or like we do on a normal Sunday night or a Wednesday night, worshiping together. That's why we gather together in this large room every week to sing songs of praise and to pray and to study and to fellowship over God's Word. Our purpose here in worship is to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ, right? It's to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you read the Psalms, the praise psalms, the worship psalms, so often what you find is, like Psalm 34:3 says, glorify the Lord with me, let us exalt His name together. Glorify the Lord with me, let us exalt His name together. There's a place for private worship, and we all ought to have that. We all ought to do that every day. There's a place for us to get together with a church like we're doing now, and a place and time for us to have private devotion with the Lord, spend time with Him. But there's nothing that really substitutes for us coming together like this and worshiping together. Now, my guess is, I know we're filming, probably on Facebook Live today, so a lot of people are watching our services on Facebook. People that can't come to church, they're going to tune in on Facebook, they're going to see it. You know what? I think that's a good thing. But it's not a substitute for being here to worship if you're able to come and be here. Now, a lot of people are not. A lot of people, maybe they're out of town, and hey, they can tune in and watch on Facebook. That's good. Or they're sick, and they can't get out. They can watch and do that. But most all of them will tell you, as most all of us will, know and understand, it's not a substitute. It's not like being in your church with your church family in the church building. It's just not. You know, I love sports, and a lot of you do. Now, I know there's a lot of advantages to watching it on TV. You know, I can take a break when I want to. Judy can pop me some popcorn, you know, those kind of things. But the atmosphere of being at the ballpark, there's just something really special about it. And that doesn't even come close. Not even close, really, to be with God's people on Sunday worshiping Him. I mean, I get excited about that, and I love it. Do you? Amen. I'm glad some of you do, yeah. We do. We ought to be excited. I look forward to worshiping with you every Sunday. I look forward to exalting our Savior together, glorifying God with Him. Psalm 100 says, to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. You know, that's what it says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. So that means we can say amen, or we could say praise the Lord, or we could lift up our hands and worship. I think the Lord would be pleased with that, actually, since the psalmist says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. So we sing, and we praise, and we honor Him about that. And then we think about being prepared to worship, and that's so important. Prepare to worship together with your brothers and sisters in Christ. I know when I was a kid, we didn't go to church all that often. Not as much as we should have, I know. But I remember when I was a little boy, my mom would, on Saturday night, we'd get prepared for worship on Sunday morning. Usually she'd get my shoes out, shine them for me. She'd wash my clothes, my Sunday clothes. iron them, lay them out, get them all ready, prepared and ready to go to church on Sunday morning. Oh, Judy shines my shoes, washes and irons my clothes, lays them out for me, and prepares me to go to church on Sunday morning. So in that respect, some things haven't changed. But think about that and how important that is. For parents, here's what you're teaching your children. Gathering together with your church family to exalt the Lord and worship Him is important. It's important. And it doesn't begin on Sunday morning. And not even Saturday night, really. It ought to begin Monday morning. And talk about it through the week with your children, with your family. We're going to church next Sunday. We're going to exalt the Lord. We're going to be with people who love us, people that we love. We're not perfect by any means, and we're going to be sitting next to people who are not either. We do things that are wrong this week in our family, and so do others. And here's what you can say to your children if you want to. It's just fine with me. You can say, Brother Stanley, not perfect either, because he's not. He's not. I'm no different from anybody else. God's just put a calling on me to preach the word to you and teach the word and to love the Lord my God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love others, love you as I love myself. That's what God's called me to do, just like it's what he's called you to do. And we're all in this thing together. And if we're going to take time to be the church, we need to connect together as we worship our Lord Jesus Christ, as we exalt him together. All throughout our lives, our married life especially, Judy and I, our closest friends have been our church family. It's not to say that we don't have friends outside. We have friends at work. We have lost friends. We have people who are neighbors that are good friends of ours. But there's just something very special about your church family. And so I would say when we come together to connect and to worship, don't just grab your seat and sit there like a frog on a log. Get up and know somebody. And somebody, we talked about this last Sunday, you could change seats every once in a while. You really could. Instead of sitting over here, you could sit over here. Instead of sitting in the middle, you could sit wherever. And you could sit by and speak to and maybe get to know somebody else that you don't know. If there's somebody in the church that you don't know that well, certainly that's what you ought to do. You ought to get up and introduce yourself and get to know them and just let them know who you are as well. You know what else it's okay to do? And we've already established this. It's great. It's fine to come down and worship at this altar and pray at this altar. Ask somebody to come with you sometime. Just ask somebody to come down and pray with you. And y'all pray together. One of the great ways to getting to know somebody is to pray with them. And to know that they're praying for you and you can pray for them. And then don't be guilty of not knowing someone's name. Now, I've been here about 6 months. I don't know every. I probably can't call everybody's name every time, but pretty much. And I want to know. I want to know your name, and we all ought to want to know one another's name. Don't be guilty of having been here a long time and not know somebody's name who's been coming for a long time, and sometimes that happens. So we don't want to be guilty of that. Showing up for worship is the first and easiest way to connect and take time to be the church. Ooh, I got to move on. Secondly, not just worshiping together, but studying together. Studying together. I love gathering like this with 150 or so people we have to worship and praise God. But the real life of our church happens in the small groups. It happens in our Sunday school classes. It happens in our discipleship training classes. It happens in our ladies' Bible study and men's Bible studies classes, in discipleship training at other classes. It happens when small groups get together where we equip God's people and we express God's love. It's where when we call out some prayer requests in a small group, we can elaborate on it a little bit without, you know, taking up the whole class time, but talk a little bit about what's going on in each other's lives and be able to pray for one another. It's about gathering together in that small group where we can study God's Word. We've got wonderful quality teachers here in this church that are teaching the Bible, teaching the Word of God, and we get to chime in on that. And we get to ask questions, and we get to interact with that. Y'all just get to listen to me when I'm out here preaching. But in your small group, you can talk, you can interact, and that's what we ought to do. These early Christians enjoyed a large group worship time. Here's what it says. They continued daily in the temple. I mean, at that point, they had not evolved to where they were just meeting in homes. They started out in the temple. They were worshiping Jesus there in the temple. And then they moved to homes. And when they moved to homes, they were in small group study time. And they were experiencing just a sharing together. They were of one accord, the Bible says. They loved Jesus and they loved one another. That's probably about all they knew at that point. But they were being taught the Word of God. They can know more about Jesus and they can know more about one another as they broke bread together, right? As they shared meals together, as they shared the Lord's Supper. If all you ever do is attend just a large group worship service, you're never going to get to know everybody and you'll never know the best that you have to offer and what the church has to offer to you in service to God and to one another. You need a network of Christian friends who you can share with, who can pray with you. And when trouble comes to your life, and it will come, you need a smaller group of friends that are going to minister to you. Every class, Sunday school, discipleship training, or whatever it is almost like a little small church within a church where the members love each other and study God's Word together. I'm glad that we have a lot of our worship attenders who also attend small group time. But if you're not, I'm encouraging you right now to get involved in a small group. Sunday school, for sure. But then on Sunday evening, discipleship training and other Bible studies together. It's where we study God's Word, learn more about Jesus, and learn more about one another. A third thing, and I'll be done in just a moment. And that is, if we're going to take time to be the church, we have to not only recognize the importance of large group worship and small group Bible study, but then, as I've really kind of talked about, sharing and caring together. Learning to share and care together. Take time to do that. Part of our job as Christians is to carry each other's burdens. That's what Paul said in Galatians 6:2. This way we fulfill the law of Christ. And fulfilling that law is to love our neighbor as ourselves. And so there are lots of examples where in small groups we carry the burdens for one another. It's where we share together. It's the body of Christ at work. It's where we connect together. And I can just tell you, I haven't had it here, but my experience in other churches and from what other pastors tell me as well is a lot of times when a member is not plugged into a small group in some way, Then when something happens and nobody responds to it, they feel left out, they feel neglected, and a lot of times they get mad, just to be quite frank. They get mad because nobody, but they weren't connected. They weren't connected, and they fell through the cracks because they didn't get involved in the life of the church. And I've had people come in to visit and rush in and sit on the back pew, and as soon as the last amen, they're out the door, and then they said, nobody spoke to me. You know, I mean, it happens. It shouldn't, but it happens. And that's why we have to work really hard. Because sometimes we have to catch those people before they get out the door and make sure that somebody spoke to them and that we really do care about them. So we got to organize as well. We need to organize sharing and caring, and that comes through the small groups as well. Folks, let me tell you this as a church. We can do everything that needs to be done in the church through small groups. Well, we can. You know, I've been 25 years in ministry, and I'm not against doing Tuesday night visitation or, you know, this or that, where we get together for a specific purpose. But generally, even in large churches, my experience has been 4 or 5 people show up, you know, out of a whole church. But if we organize to care for one another through the small groups, everybody can get ministered to and nobody falls through the cracks. Now, you need to let your pastor know what's going on, right? You need to let your pastor and staff know and your deacons know who's sick, who's having surgery, and those things. But think about how marvelous we can multiply ministry if everybody within the church family ministered to one another. You know what? That's a biblical concept. That's what the Bible teaches. Equip the saints for the work of the ministry. And so that's what we should do. And as your pastor, I want to be there ministering to you. I want to be at the hospital. I want to be at your surgery. I'm going to do all I can, but I'm one person. I can't do it all. But all of us can work together to share and care for one another. It's a great way to connect. When your Sunday school class organizes a meal for you because you've had surgery, it shows that you care. When there's somebody having surgery and the pastor or some of the staff can't be there, but some of the Sunday school class shows up, it shows them that you care, that the church cares about them. It's a great way to do ministry. It's the way that we connect together. It takes some time, yes, but we have to do it. I'll end on this illustration. Several years ago, Judy and I bought a little place over at Faulkner where we moved from, and it had an old farmhouse there. And we were doing some work on it, you know, trying to get it ready to kind of livable. And in the back, especially in the back, around the eaves and all, there were just huge cracks, you know, everywhere. I bought, I don't know how many cases of caulk. I mean, I case after case of caulk to fill in those cracks and fill in those holes, keep the dirt daubers out. I mean, it took a lot of caulk and a lot of time to fill in those cracks and get them ready where everything was sealed up tight and everything was as it should be. Folks, there are always going to be some cracks in the church, right? Always going to be some cracks in our lives. But if we work together and we take the time to do so, we can let God use us to fill in those cracks and make everything as it should be. Make the church tight, tight together, connected together, loving God and loving others. As the church, we need to reach out to one another. But you have to have Jesus in your heart before you can do that, really, effectively. You have to know Christ as Lord and Savior. Jesus loves you. He wants to save you. He wants you to be a part of the family. And we want that too. If you're here and you're lost, I'm begging you to give your heart and life to Jesus. Become a part of this church family. We'd love to have you as a part of our family, worshiping and serving together. None of us are perfect. And some folks are probably going to fall through the cracks at times and things are going to happen. But we learn as the church to be kind and forgiving and learn to reconcile to one another. I mean, Jesus died on the cross to reconcile us to God. We can be reconciled to one another if we'll surrender to Him. If we'll take the time to be the church, God will be honored and He'll be glorified. Let's pray together. Heads bowed, eyes closed just for a moment as we pray. Now, considering how God and what He wants us to do in response to His word today. Once again, this message has been geared towards the church, towards the saved, no doubt. But again, if you're here and you're without Jesus, then certainly, God wants you to be a part of His family. I mean, we are children of God when we come to faith in Christ, and that's what He wants for your life. So I'm asking you, as God's Word tells us to do, to admit our sinfulness, that we recognize that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, that's every one of us, and that the wages of our sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And if we believe in our heart that Jesus is God's Son, that God raised Him from the dead, if we confess that with our mouth and call on His name, He'll save us. And He wants to save you. And in saving you, you automatically become a part of the church. A part of God's saved, God's redeemed, God's family. But then God wants you to be in a local church family. A local church family. We want you to be here. If God's calling you to be here and God wants you to be here. And you know that. You know if He does or not. So if you're here today and you're lost, please, we just want to see you saved. If you're here today and you're saved but you're not a member here, you know you need to be plugged into a local church family, we'd love to have you here. We'd love to accept you this morning. Come down and talk to me about it during the time of response. Father, help us now as we have this time of response to please and honor You through our obedience to You, Father. And we obey You simply because we love You, Father. And we want to just respond to Your great love to us in a way that shows we love and care for You and we love one another. So, Father, right now, as we have this time of response, again, may it please You is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our hymn of response.
I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give.
do whatever God's put on your heart. Whatever you need to do, publicly or privately, right there at your seat, I want you to be faithful to God. Just be faithful. Just surrender it all to Him. Let's continue to sing. And if you want to come and deal with the altar and pray or crusade or you have some other need, please do so. If I can help you or pray with you from God's Word, please come down and do that. Let's continue to sing that verse 3.
All to Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessings fall on me.
I want you to know that I feel the closeness of this church family, and I'm grateful for that and thankful for each and every one of you. As we get ready to dismiss, I want to share with you that, as I mentioned about small group Bible studies and Sunday school, how important that is. Mary Alice Hall is teaching a class, Sunday school class, and she's inviting anyone who is not a member to come on and join that group on Sunday mornings. They're going to begin a new study. It's actually a follow-up to the Not a Fan that they just finished, and the name of this study is The End of Me. The End of Me. And so if you'll let her know if you want to be a part of this study so she can get a book ordered, that'll be great. Anyone who wants to take part in that study, just see Mary Alice. As we mentioned, we're going to take a love offering, and we'll have some guys. We need some guys at the back. Some of you guys, grab a plate and go to our four doors. Y'all will do that. And this is for the Carpenter family. Derek's dad passed away a while back, and this is to help them with funeral expenses. So it's a free will love offering. You feel led to give, you're certainly welcome to do that. If you did not come prepared today and you still want to do it, all you have to do is just mark it designated anytime this week or next Sunday as well. So we've got some guys at the doors if you want to give. I hope you have a great afternoon. Remember, no services here tonight. We're not canceling services. We're just moving our service to Northeast Football Stadium for the GoTel Crusade tonight, and we're doing the same thing Wednesday night. So I hope to see you there tonight. I hope to see you there Wednesday night. If you can make it Monday and Tuesday, that'd be awesome too. I hope that you can, 7 o'clock. All right, any other word before we dismiss today? Thank you again to our guests that are here. We love having you. We want you to come back and worship with us again and worship with us anytime. We'd love to have you. Yes, Myra. Yes. Thank you. Thank you for reminding us of that. Miss Sarah Benjamin is having, she's having heart surgery on Tuesday morning. She has to be at the hospital really early. And so let's pray for Miss Sarah as she's facing this surgery. We have several that had surgery this past week, so we got a lot of folks recovering as well. So I want us to pray for all those who are sick. Okay, any others? All right. Again, I hope you have a great afternoon. Love you all very much. Mike Ford, will you dismiss us in prayer, please?